Hey everyone, it's David with Neo7CNC, and I've got another Jump Box episode for you. I've got some new tools that I'd like to show you. I've got some horse trading to do, and I want to just give you an update on some of the things that have been going on, and I have some questions for you as well. So please stick around and we'll get right into it. All right, so this first thing I want to show you is a new tool that I purchased. You've heard me mention these guys before, but this is Noga. This is not the new one, but this is a deburr tool, and I absolutely love these. They come in handy. This particular set came with four different diameter tips, so you can actually get into, not only can you do the counter bore, but you can do the bore inside the counter bore, the through hole, if you use a smaller size. But I use this all the time. I ran into something recently to where I didn't have a big enough head for the hole that I was trying to countersink. So I ended up, I guess, buying the big brother. And this thing is quite beefy with this big gooseneck piece that's on it. But nice plastic handles, very freely moving. And this works great. I actually like the single edge versions better. They don't tend to be so grabby. The double edge version does grab more, but it still works quite well. So that's my latest piece of Noga gear that I bought. All right, so these next items I actually got at a yard sale. And I was just rummaging through some of the boxes and I came across this stash of screwdrivers. And I could smell them before I could see them. And any of you that have been around any old Craftsman plastic handled tools, you know exactly what I'm talking about. You may have seen AVE do something where he was talking about the screwdrivers and how the plastic, when it gets old and it starts deteriorating, it gives off quite the unpleasant smell. And so that's what I smelled first when I was digging down through the bags. But I started seeing stuff that looked different. And I started seeing these screwdrivers. And the reason they caught my eye, one, is the condition is really, really good, but this, the where the screwdriver blade actually meets up with the handle, you don't usually see this much anymore, at least I don't. And so these two is very long. This one looks like it may have had some rust on it at some point, but it's still quite usable, fairly straight. I ended up seeing a couple more. Got one Phillips that looks a little different. It doesn't have the same aesthetic on it as this one does. And then here's a very thin, flat, standard screwdriver. I started seeing lots of other tools in there as well. So I've got this, all these different pliers. I'll come back to these guys here in a minute. This pair of cutters that was unique, missing the handle, but unique. Some very basic electrician scissors or datacom scissors, whatever you want to call them. And then I saw this, which I'm very familiar with this tool. In my IT realm of responsibilities, I've had my fair share of telephone stuff to do. So I actually have one of these that's in a lot less used condition, but needless to say, I knew what that was. And then I saw this, and this is a Fuller 8-inch, and this is made in Japan. But it's in really good shape, and the thing that caught my eye was the narrowness of the face here, how narrow it is right here. That's not typical of a lot of the adjustable wrenches that I have. So I saw all this stuff, and I kind of cherry picked the stuff out, and I asked one of the people that was setting the yard sale up. I'm like, "What do you want for this stuff?" And I was hesitant to say anything because I didn't want to insult anybody. So I just kind of let them throw out the first thing. And somebody mentioned $5. And I was like, there's no way I can sleep with a good conscience if I bought that for $5. Not even knowing really what they're worth, but I was just intrigued. They're quality tools. This doesn't even have a name on it, but you can just tell it's in really good shape. There's no dings in the blade on it. And that's a good size. And then I'll get to the real thing that caught my eye here in a second. But they just look like quality tools. They look like old tools, and I was interested. So I threw out $30, and the guy actually laughed at me, thinking that was too much. And I said, "Look, I don't want to insult anybody. I'm not trying to pull a fast one on anybody. I like these tools. They're old, and you know, I'd like to get them. And the gentleman that actually brought these to the yard sale, he said, well, before I tell you what he said, let me show you what's on here. And so you're not going to be able to read this in the shot, but this says Bell Systems, and what's the thing on the bottom? This one says Bridgeport. So Bell Systems Bridgeport, this is made by Stanley, but it says Bell Systems and it's got a serial number on it. Bell Systems E, made Stanley, made in America. Bell Systems Bridgeport, I assume it was made by Stanley because these two have the little fillet on the neck there. And then this I thought was cool. So this is a pair of needle nose pliers, but it's got this little catch right here, if you can see that in the shot. And I don't know if that's for like hanging it on a tool belt or what that might be for, but these are channel lock. It says channel lock here, Meadville, PA, USA. It's got a number on here, looks like 8810, and then it also has Bell Systems in the very bottom of it right there. And these are in great shape. I don't know how old these things are. They don't have a cutter on them, which is odd. Sorry. They don't have a cutter on them, which is odd, but they're in really good shape. A little bit of surface rust, but not much. But the handles are in really good shape considering how old they must be. But I ended up giving them, they said, sure, $30 is great. And then the guy that brought these spoke up and he said that his parents worked for Bell Systems and that they would really love the fact that somebody knew what these were and wanted to, you know, and appreciated them. So he was happy with the $30. And I told him, I said, I want to make sure that y'all are good with this, but here's a cable knife. You probably don't see these much anymore. And then I wasn't exactly sure what this was. It has a number on it here, KS16750L2. And it's just a rod on here. And it's not a screwdriver or anything. It's just kind of a wire sticking out. And I asked if that was something for like maybe like a spudger or something that's used to get wires off of like a punch down block or a 66 block or a 110 block. And they seem to think that that's what it was for. But being that it's paired with the cable knife, I wonder if it wasn't for something for maybe pulling the strain relief filaments out of a cable or who knows what, or for wire wrapping. I don't know. That is kind of bent and it looks like it was probably pressed somehow and the heat got to it over time. But I just thought that was interesting as well. But this tool is very usable. It has a 66 block cutter bit in one side, a punch down and a cutter blade. And then in the very bottom of it, it has a 110. It's marked 88, but I recognize this as a 110 punch down tool. So that's a good set right there. You can find them used on eBay for not a whole lot of money, but if you do this kind of work, this is a good tool to have. And sometimes you can even get center punches and things to snap in here, and it's certainly good for that because this is actually an impact tool if you're not familiar with the punch down blocks and stuff like that. But you basically would do it like that and it strikes. I don't know if you could see that. Yeah, so you push it down just like a center punch and it strikes. You can actually adjust how hard it hits with this little thing right here. So I gave them 30 bucks, everybody was happy. These things, they don't have a name on them, but man, they are built solid. You see how thick that is? That is just crazy. Very heavy duty, adjustable pliers. Looks like they've gotten some grinding done to them at some point, but still just sturdy. I mean, there's hardly any give to them. I just thought those were good. And the last thing here, and this has no maker's mark that I can find. I don't see anything on this, but the jaws of this, it has a little divot out of there like it was used for stripping wires. But then if you actually turn the side, you can see that groove in there. So it looks like it's got wire strippers on both sides and in the center. And these move very freely. They're missing the handles or the dipped handles, but still, I just thought that was neat that they were something different. So I got all this and something else that was in the box that I wasn't really sure. I knew I wouldn't do anything with it, but let me move this out of the way to give this the geek respect that I believe that's due. This is a butt set, which is a test set basically for an old phone system. And what you would do is you have these wires that are on here. These are fabric coated wires. And this, you would usually, any lineman that you saw climbing a telephone pole would most likely have one of these. So this is really secured on here really good. Some of them you would actually see a hanger right here for hanging it on your belt. And this is a handset, basically. You have a talk switch, and then you have a monitor switch on the side here. And I don't know, this almost feels like a rubber kind of thing. It's not flexible so much, but these right here feel like they're Bakelite. But on the back of this is for a rotary phone. So I was thinking that the little dial thing is missing, because I'm old enough to remember having to dial the numbers and waiting for the rotary phone to finish. But this is actually, it's actually in here. So the rotary part still works. It's got that nice old solid feel to it. And they ended up, they were like, I had $40 on me, and I didn't want them to have to make change, because they weren't actually trying to do the yard sale, and the I think their proceeds were going to the Boy Scouts. So I said, you know, just keep the extra $10. I know y'all will use it. So we just left it at that. And they went back and they started pricing the table that had this stuff on it, and they saw this and they're like, you know what that is, just take it. You know, you gave us 10 extra bucks. So I have it. I have no idea what I'll do with it. I would love this to go to like a museum or a display or something. I couldn't stand to see it. And this is what I told them. I said, I'll take it. I don't know what I'll do with it, but I can't stand to think that that's going to end up in the recycle box or in the e-waste box. So I don't know. I don't know what to do with this. I can't use it. But I would love to see it be appreciated by somebody or an establishment or something. But anyway, that's just a cool old piece of technical history, I think. All right, so here's another linear actuator that needs a home. And this one is not made by THK. This one is actually a Rexroth Star. This is made in Germany. And let's see, it has roughly 5 1/4 inches or 134 millimeters of travel. The ball screw looks to be a single starch 2 millimeter lead. And the mount on this is a 50 millimeter across on the diagonals. And it's got this little spacer ring that can either be there or not. This one has a coupling with it, a nice helical coupling. So that looks like a 6 millimeter. Let me tell you what it is instead of guessing what it is. That looks like that's going to be a 6 millimeter acceptance on the coupler, but a really nice, really compact little actuator that needs a home. You know, if you're interested in it, horse trading or buy it, just let me know. I've got one more linear actuator, at least one that's complete. And this is another THK linear actuator, KR33 type. And this has a mount of 40 millimeters across the diagonal, 6 millimeter drive. This is a double start 3 millimeter lead, and it has 1.75 inches of travel, or roughly 48 millimeters. So if you've got some short throw application like a pick and place, maybe a laser adjustment for height, who knows, a small CNC machine, this could work for that. But again, it's all, the KR33s are, they're very heavy, they're built very well, and I think this is the last one that I have to get rid of. So there's that. I have this. This is the guts of some sort of industrial, like Silicon Valley type actuator. The reason I held on to it, it has this very nice little ball screw, and I've got the end bearing, and this DC motor, which looks like it's probably a Maxon DC motor with some sort of controller board on it. Looks like it's got a planetary gear, and that's what drives this ball screw. So I kept all of this together, and there is a min and max cherry switch that's already built into this, so that could easily be incorporated into a 3D printer or some pick and place or some other sort of adjustment system. Made very well. I can't remember what this came out of exactly, but it was a piece of probably Silicon Valley wafer handling or something, some cool piece of gear. So if that's something that you can make use of, let me know. Let me move that right there. I didn't mention this one last time, but this is just a rod. This actually came out of a, this came out of a computer. I think it was a LTO library for backup tapes. And these are, what are these? It's got a name on them. These are Thompson Super 12. Is that right? Yep, Super 12. Yeah. They're right on this ground shaft. It's got this little plate that screws onto the end of it. I couldn't stand to throw it away. I don't really have a use for it. It has a hole on this side too. But somebody might be able to use that for like a, that would probably be good, build a clamp for this and make some sort of slide cutting fixture for, I don't know, a chop saw, router table, who knows. But that's looking for a home. And then this guy right here, I was originally wanting to use this for a 3D printer when I was going to build one. And it's made to be mounted like this, which I thought would be great. You can't even see that in the shot. Let's fix that. Why don't we? Maybe. A little better. All right, so this guy, it has a lead screw on it, which rolls quite freely. And then it's got this linear bearing. This is a, what is that? An IKO, that looks like an ML15, so a 15 millimeter linear bearing there. And this little piece right here actually connects to this lead screw nut and then bolts to this. So this whole apparatus will slide up and down. And what I was thinking was this could be milled to make this a ledge, or this could be completely remade. And then this would be an absolutely great Z-axis for a 3D printer, especially with the mount flanges being down here. It does have these slot mounts right here, so you could put you a stepper motor or a servo motor right here and then put a belt between those two and you'd be in business. So this looks like it's a cast piece that was been machined afterwards. So really cool little setup, but I haven't used it yet and I'm not going to. I just don't have the time. So that's available as well. And so very quickly, the last thing that I'll offer up are the last things, as I have the, and I'm trying to remember here, these are Kaling KL23H286-20-8B from Kaling, K-E-L-I-N-G Technology. And I have four of these. Now, if I remember correctly, these are either 425-ounce or 450-ounce dual-shaft stepper motors. I have four of these, and then I have the drivers that I used to run them. And I have four of these, and these are also Kaling. These are KL6050s. And so I have four of the drivers, I have four of the steppers. And these are the ones that were actually on my large CNC machine before it got converted to the Schneider Electric hybrid steppers. So these things ran like a top. I never had any issue at all with them. They had more than enough power to run my DIY CNC machine. So let me know if somebody's working on a build, that may be a good place to start. And those are NEMA 23 mounts. All right, I know what you're thinking. Come on, David, not more hard drives. We're tired of hard drives. I get it. But the reason I'm showing you these is I want to do a size comparison. Now, anybody in the tech realm is going to recognize these as a standard desktop style hard drive and a laptop style hard drive, or more importantly these days, an SSD hard drive. Now, I wanted to show you these so I can show you something a little bit different that you may not have seen before. And so I'm going to put some references out here. Here's a Canadian loonie, a dollar piece. Here's a US quarter. And here is a 1 euro. So that's the size comparison. This grid is 1 inch by 1 inch, or roughly 25 millimeters by 25 millimeters. And I wanted to show you the smallest hard drive that I have ever seen. And here it is. I'm going to zoom you in so you can see it for reference. And here is the hard drive. It's a little dusty. I've actually kept this on my desk at work just because I thought it was neat. And a lot of people haven't seen the insides of a hard drive. And so this was a good example of what's going on here. So you got the platter, which is just barely, it's about the size of a loonie, a dollar Canadian coin. And you've got your little wiper arm there. This is what houses the head right here. And that head would sweep across and pivot on this piece right here. And then the magnet for this one would either be this top piece or it would be below the copper coil that you may be able to see in the shot on the bottom side. So I do believe that this was a compact flash hard drive for a camera or some other high data capacity in its day. I don't remember what the capacity of this was, but I'm sure it's not much. But anyway, I just wanted to share that. I thought about it today when I was at work, and I'm like, I bet there's a lot of people that hadn't seen one quite that small. So, all right, so I've got some things that I want to cover with you that have either been neglected or they've recently come to my mind, and I've been like, you know, what if, blah, blah, blah. So the first thing is, whatever became of the channel that was copying all of my content? And thanks to you guys, that channel went away in about a week. Now, if you're not familiar with this situation, last year I had a channel that popped up, and I can't even remember the name of the channel, but another YouTuber very graciously let me know, hey, you may want to check this channel out. Looks like they're copying some, if not all, of your content. And so I did go and check it out, and sure enough, they were copying all of my videos and clipping off like the first 17 seconds of my video, which included my logo in the very beginning and the music that I use, and then the rest of the video they just copied. And they didn't make any attempt to cover up my voice or anything, my name, nothing. And so I was like, well, that's pretty ballsy of a move, I would say. I would find out later that they did an even ballsier move that I'll share here in a second. So as fast as I could refresh, about every 10 minutes, I would see a new video of mine show up on their channel. And I kind of panicked and started doing the YouTube submission to submit for content that was ripped off, basically. And that was a very tedious process to where I had to go in and do a copyright claim and say that they're copying my content and it starts at 17 seconds and goes to 5.5 minutes and blah, blah, blah. I had to do that for every video. And so I got through three of those requests and I was like, this is gonna take eons because I was having to go find their copy of the video, see when the copyright infringement started, see where it ended, and it just went on and on and on. I couldn't just say, hey, go look at this channel. They've ripped me off. And so I kind of mentioned on YouTube, and so many of you guys came to bat and started kind of knocking on YouTube. And after about a week, the channel disappeared. But not before I posted the video talking about the channel that had ripped me off. They copied that video and put it on their channel. And I was just like, wow, that right there just proves that it was some sort of bot that they had that was just siphoning off content from other channels and claiming it as their own, and they were trying to get ad revenue behind that. I would imagine that I probably wouldn't fly today with the new restrictions that YouTube's put on about monetizing videos and how many, you gotta have so many subscribers and you gotta have so many channel views. I guess that would probably nip that in the bud had it been in place. But anyway, thank you guys for knocking YouTube enough that they said, let's just delete that other channel. So I really appreciate it. Some other things that have been on my mind recently, and I'm referencing my phone here if you see me looking down. Is there something that I can cover in a video that I haven't already covered or that I can cover better? I know my video quality is not epic. It is not this old Tony. It is not a lot of things. It's usually pretty much cut and dry to the point. And I'm working on that. I hope that I can make it more enjoyable to watch me drone on about things. I'm trying. But is there something that I could cover that, like I said, hasn't been covered before on the channel, or that needs to be covered in better detail, or that just needs to be reshot altogether? I've got several videos out there that I think are better than most, where I'm explaining using the brake, and I'm showing you how to use the brake, showing you how to wire in the opto isolator, different things, connecting the smooth stepper to the clear path, or the clear path to a C10 board, different things like that. But is there another video that you'd like to see? So let me know, and it can be anything. It can be something in the shop. It can be, how did you do something in here? Whatever the case may be, I'm open to suggestions, but I just wanted to know if there's something that kind of floats to the top that I can help do a video on. What about doing a live stream? If you saw me, I think it was New Year's Eve, somewhere in there, with the help of Tom Zalikman from Inspiration Metalworks YouTube channel. He, after answering a couple of messages on Instagram, he got me very quickly pointed in the right direction with a streaming solution. And after one false start of a black, completely blank live stream with no audio, video, or anything, once I got past that, then, you know, I got on there, and me and several of you guys chit-chatted for, I don't know, 45 minutes or something like that. I had some meat on the smoker and had to go tend to that, so I had to go check on the fire, but I think about 20 or 25 of us got in there, and we're just kind of kicking around. And that was a lot of fun. It was fun to interact with you guys and ask questions. And got a lot of good information. And one of you guys, and I'm sorry, I'm losing it, is helping me with getting the spindle working with the USB smooth stepper. That's still a work in progress, but I really appreciate that. But the camaraderie and the interaction with you guys was very, very enjoyable. So would a live stream be something that interests you guys? And it could be, you know, an ask me anything kind of thing. It can be, what do you think about this? Or let's look at a design and see what the pros and cons are. It could be whatever. So is that something you would be interested in or have the time to do? And we can schedule it on the weekends would be best. But if it's late one evening during the week, I can certainly accommodate that. Even if it's in the morning, you know, before I go to work, it's whatever. It's whatever you guys would like to try. So let me know what you think about that down below. Always, you can hit me with any of this stuff. If you don't want to put it in front of everybody, you want to send it to me. If it's a critique, whatever it is, hit me up at questions@neo7cnc.com. I'll do my best to answer you as quickly as possible. The last thing, excuse me. The last thing is, there's a lot of channels that I support by buying a t-shirt from them, whether it's Keith Finner, Tom Zalikman, Hatfield Industries, Electro Boom, if you know who I'm talking about. I think those are the ones that I have that I can remember right now. A lot of channels do t-shirts, and I like having t-shirts of guys that I support and I enjoy watching. And would that be something that you guys would be interested in? I would probably do a Teespring campaign or something like that. But let me know. We could collaborate and come up with a design, come up with a slogan, a saying, whatever it may be. I saw one today that was completely not CNC related, but it was like, you bought yours, I built mine, something like that. I don't know. I don't want to be snappy or rude, but some sort of saying. I don't know what the saying would be, but who knows. But anyway. So those are some things that were on my mind. I just wanted to kind of talk to you about it. I hope you are okay with just the kind of sitting across the table format here. But let me know your thoughts on all of this stuff I unloaded on you just recently. So any suggestions, you know, live stream, t-shirts, what kind of content you want to see, let me know. So anyway, if you made it this far, thank you. I really appreciate it. I hope you're a subscriber. If you're not, please consider it. We'd love to have you. And I really appreciate your time, and thanks for watching, and we'll talk to you next time.